Great to be here, folks. It's Lorcan again from the Men's Development Network, and I'm delighted to be here and to welcome you all on behalf of our team who are in the background here for our conversation today, which is going to focus on men and mental health. Now, today we hope to take a strengths-based approach to the conversation we're going to have. We hope to identify some really new approaches and programs and initiatives that may be a support in relation to our practice for supporting ourselves with our mental health and supporting others if we're part of service provision as well. As always, we have some really, really interesting people along with us, and we're going to introduce you to some of those in a few moments. Just to begin, as always, I like to acknowledge very much at the beginning the partners who make this conversation happen. First of all, IMS, who are in the background, and Anna Marie, who's after introducing me, and she'll be minding us with her team there for the next while and looking after us. But most especially then as well, we have the Health Service Executive, who are parting supportive of these webinars that have run last year, and hopefully we will have three for you this year. So we hope you'll stay with us, not just for today, but indeed for those other engagements as well. We have the Men's Health Forum in Ireland there in the background. Collie Fowler is there as well. And we have the Men's Development Network. Myself is here up front at the moment. And we've the Southeast Technological University. Lowell Richards is in the background there as well. He's always very much part of these events. Later in our webinar, folks, we'll have Fergal Fox along. Everybody knows Fergal probably at this stage, so I'm not going to give him a long introduction, but he will come along later in the day and he will tell us more about some of the initiatives and the programs and what's happening in the world of HSE and beyond in relation to good initiatives for mental health and wellbeing. Today, I think we're going to have what I would call nearly a sacred conversation. We have switched around somewhat the way we're working with our webinar. Usually we maybe have presentation and then we might have a conversation. Today we're going to roll through the next hour or so in the company of some really good people having conversations around mental health and framing it hopefully in a way that would be helpful to us individually as people ourselves, but also, as I say, as service providers. In a few moments' time, I'm going to introduce us to the very first person that we have up here, and he's clinical psychologist Mark Smith. But before we do that, I'm going to call there on Dana Marie to show a very short video. I think it's only about 17 seconds, but it will help us frame the conversation that we're going to have. And I'll introduce Mark as well. So roll it there, please, Dana.
Not feeling yourself, trouble sleeping, ongoing stress, anxiety, or low mood? They're all part of your mental health. Find support at yourmentalhealth.ie from the HSE.
Now, that is a lovely introduction, Mark, for you. But before I even say anything to you, I just want to say that you're a senior psychologist, child adolescent mental health services. You work a lot with teenagers around stress and anxiety. You're past president of Psychological Society of Ireland, and you're clinical lead to Rugby Players Ireland Services as well. And you're a media contributor, and you're here with us to help us start the conversation. Mark, can I ask you before anything else, before we frame this, because you're going to contextualize the conversation we want to have. I woke up this morning and I had elephants for butterflies, and I was thinking about mental health, and I was thinking about the things that we put ourselves through and we come out to lead a conversation. You're here with me on the screen right now. People are looking in, our friends from all around the country and maybe and further than that as well. A lot of people online here today. And I'm just thinking, when I often hear in the framing of the language mental health, we feel maybe it's in our heads, but the range of emotions that go with that word that we use in relation to mental health, for me this morning, certainly, to make it to the screen. Tell me something about that and help me to see, is it just me or is it everybody? That, you know, we have this thing around self-esteem, turning up, trying to get through the day and maybe seeing what is it that's happening within us in relation to our emotional mental health.
We've got an hour.
We have an hour. 10 minutes.
I think we've come a long way with the conversations that we have about mental health. But I think sometimes we have to refine those conversations. So like you talked about this morning, that feeling of kind of butterflies, that little bit of performance anxiety, the worry about kind of something going well, that's normal. And I think we need to keep that as part of the conversation, that we don't, in a rush to understand things better, that we don't pathologize ordinary emotions. So interestingly, a lot of the work that I've been doing over the last maybe year or so is trying to recontextualize some of the things that people have been going through as an expected reaction to life's events. So it's okay to be anxious. It's normal. It's actually quite helpful in some situations. We know that a moderate degree of anxiety actually improves performance in an academic setting or a sporting setting. So I think it's about accepting, you know, that full range of emotions that we all experience, and knowing and being educated about and having conversations about when any emotion, anxiety or anything else, tips in and goes above that level that we can tolerate. And then we have to have a different conversation.
And in the context of men and mental health, because we're here specifically, not just generic, but we're speaking about men and mental health. And just to begin by saying, there are many types of expression of masculinities. They're not just one type of man in the world. And there's a very creative and expressive kind of masculinity, I suppose, in the context of when you're looking at men and men in our lives, you know, where do you think we maybe have picked up in the past some of the stories that make it more difficult? For example, like myself, to say, start off by saying, acknowledging the challenge you'd have around coming out here to lead on something like this today. Where is that coming from, or what's that about for us as men?
I've come a long way. I think we still have some ways to go. And there is, unfortunately, I think over maybe the last year or two, elements of what people describe as toxic masculinity coming back into the conversations again. So I think in previous older generations, there was this sense of, you know, the man goes out to work and whatever the problems are, you keep it to yourself, or you go for a pint and you don't talk to anyone and you bottle it all up. And because talking about your emotions was, I think, wrongly perceived as a sign of vulnerability, and you weren't supposed to do that because it was very kind of patriarchal structure. And I think because we're having these conversations, because we focus on reducing stigma, particularly targeting men, about not just getting permission, but encouraging people to show those vulnerabilities. I think what I reflect on over the last while is that by us doing that now, we're reducing the likelihood of this kind of continuing as an intergenerational thing, that our kids are watching us. And I'm very conscious as a man, as a dad, of my son and how he sees me express emotions, and giving him permission to do it because I am. So I'm hoping in future generations that this will become a thing of the past because we're now leading out. And I think for us as adult men, we're seeing fantastic role models that are leading the way. So I know we have David Gillick. He did a panel like this for us in PSI last year. We see Rugby Players Ireland with Tackle Your Feelings. We see GAA players. So we see people very publicly talking about being vulnerable and being okay with that. And I think that initiates that conversation that gives us permission to continue it.
If you were to frame mental health for us as we begin into the conversation, we'll be here for the next 50 minutes or more now. How do you frame it in the context of your clinical practice, from the World Health Organization definition, or just to give us something that we can kind of walk through with the really good people that we're going to have on our panel discussion with David as well? You know, how would you frame it for yourself, Mark, in your clinical practice background and your own personal experience?
Sure. I suppose we all have mental health, but when one of the key things for us, so when we're monitoring our mental health and how we're doing, it's going to go up and down. It's never going to be a straight line. That's just being human. But I suppose the key things to watch out for are when aspects of our mental health are kind of deteriorated and they're continuing over a prolonged period of time. We're not really getting that break back from it, where it's continuous. And I think one of the key pieces is when we start to withdraw, when we stop doing things that we normally would have done, where we stop enjoying things that we would have enjoyed, where our mental health is getting in the way of activities of daily living, everyday life. It's making it just harder, and we're struggling to find a way back from it. I think that's when we really need to start paying attention to it. I think mental health is not about the big things. So it's not about, you know, serious mental illness and waiting up to that point. It's noticing and being aware of everyday stressors. So what I see with men in particular is that they don't pay attention to the small things, where they're a little bit stressed, or a bit anxious about something, a bit low, or the sleep is not great. And they see them as all very distinct things rather than all being part of the same continuum. What we know is that the cumulative impact of lots and lots and lots of little stressors will have the same impact as one big stressor. So if we can pay attention to the smaller things and make smaller changes, it's less likely to build up into something that feels overwhelming.
We've already said there's not just one type of masculinity. So I'm just wondering, in the context of what you're saying, are there some demographics of men or masculinities that would struggle more in relation to being or doing or acting or asking rather than other groups? And if so, why is that, do you think?
Yeah, so we know that young men in range of kind of 18 to 35 are particularly vulnerable. I think there's lots of reasons for that. Again, perceptions of what it is to be a man, sometimes how that's shaped by social media. And just this sense of identity. I think there are figures where we have really positive role models that are shaping kind of men along being vulnerable. We have other very powerful influencers who are shaping a very negative conversation, I think, about men and about what they need to be. And I suppose there's a battle between both. But young men in that age demographic are very much influenced by social media. They spend a lot of time online, and they see that somebody who, you know, could have over a million followers is advocating, you know, holding your feelings in and being the man in a very negative way. They're torn between those. So we have to be engaging, I think, on social media. We have to be targeting those young men through the mediums that they use. And like we are using webinars, but I think also using the social media platforms that they're using. So I get a lot of you know, young men who are now exploring and looking for ideas around their mental health on TikTok. And I think societally and with large organizations, we can often be a little one or two steps behind. So, you know, we put stuff on our website, but, you know, it'll capture a large proportion. But we want to make sure we capture everybody. So I think there's both a challenge and an opportunity for us to embrace all of those different types of social media platforms and mediums as they evolve and to be brave. Because essentially, when we're encouraging people to come forward and talk about their mental health, we're asking them to be brave, to take that chance to open up. And I think organizationally, we all need to be brave as well and maybe take steps that we're a little uncomfortable with if it means we're going to reach out to people who need it.
Now, we're post a world pandemic that's really probably is going to be 10 years before the sociologists will look in at sociology and see where it's impacting on us. I'm just wondering, you've said we've come a long way in relation to service response, and we're all part of services. Services are made up of people who are out doing our best, you know, even on the challenging days. What do you identify with some of the good stuff that's there in your own clinical practice as well and experience? What do you see that maybe we're getting right, especially in relation to, you know, promoting that story that you're talking about where men can feel, yeah, that service is for me, I can make that phone call?
I think what we're doing is we're talking to each other better. I think in the past, more services operated more as silos where they all did their own thing independently. I think what's happened a lot better over the last while, particularly I think since COVID, is that there's more of an integration between services and communication plans and talking about how are we going to get this message out and focusing on the messaging, but also think we're getting better at asking people, you know, what works for you? So we're having these focus groups with young people. We're having online kind of questionnaires and surveys tell us the feedback, because we're not afraid of it anymore. We want to know what is it that works for you and what doesn't work for you. How can we shape that? How can we do things differently? And I think what COVID showed us is that we have to adapt, and in the face of adversity, we can adapt really, really quickly. But I think also there's opportunities where we don't need to have a big global pandemic to identify what needs to be changed, and to have that bravery to adapt systems, no matter how old they are, to make them work for people better. And I think we do that by asking them, engaging with them, having those conversations and being open to whatever the response is. So I think we've got better at that, but there's always room for improvement. So in any given situation, we're doing the best that we can with what we have, but there's always room for us to do better.
Believe it or not, we're running on time already. It's a short window we have you on just to frame this webinar for us. But I'm really interested, as a clinical practitioner yourself, I'd love to talk about your own journey into that, you know, physician, heal thyself. What draws us into the work that we do? It's really interesting. But for people watching here today and who have joined us and themselves or family members, or whatever, for yourself in the work and staying well in the work, what have you found that's really been helpful and supportive for yourself as a man in the kind of work that you do? And then the last thing, just I'll put the two of them together. What word would you say to somebody maybe watching in here today in relation to maybe needing to make that call or find that support?
I think one of the things that's really important to me in doing this kind of work is the how genuine the therapeutic relationship is with the person you're working with. You have to not just come across, but be genuine with them, or else it's hard to find that sense of connection. So one of the things I find hardest is to not be a hypocrite about the advice that I give, and to know that I have to do my best to try and follow it as well. And that's not easy. And I acknowledge that with people sometimes, that I've tried to do things and I don't always get it right, but I try and keep doing it. But I think it's important that we schedule stuff in advance. So life is so busy, we often take on too many things, we say yes to too many things, and we shouldn't find things in our diary incidentally. We have to take time to sit down. No, I'm going to put that aside. I'm going to spend time to go off and do something with the kids or to play around the golf or whatever it is that works for us, and to stick to it. Because, you know, we often go, well, look, I'll just put this extra work in. I'll bring the phone with me. I'll bring the laptop and say, no, that's going to protect the time. Because, you know, we all have to mind each other. I think of that second piece about seeking help. I think one of the most important pieces is not to neglect the support that we already have around us. If we're lucky enough to have, you know, family that might be close by, or friends, or just a colleague, or in a sports coach, or somebody that we just trust. We don't need to expect them to have all the answers to whatever we're going through, but sometimes it's just to have someone who will listen non-judgmentally, who doesn't come up with an instant fix that's going to just give us the answer there and then. It's just someone to download to sometimes. And that in itself can be just all that we need. I mean, sometimes my role is just sitting there and listening and nodding and just being a safe, non-judgmental space. And friends and family can do that too.
Look, at Mark, it's been really lovely. I'd love to have so much more time with you, and your lovely temperament. My butterflies are gently resting on the leaf here after speaking with you. So really thank you very much for being on and helping us to frame the conversation for where we're going. And we'll bring some of that on to our panel as well later on. So go well, and thank you very, very, very much. That's our Mark, and that's a really good framing of where I think it is we want to go. And it's a lovely introduction, really, into the conversation I want to have with our next guest. But that's David Gillick, and he mentioned David. David's well known. I'll say a little bit about him in a few moments. But I want you to watch this, folks. This is what it's like when you really do get it right. And it's David in action a few years ago. And he's going to talk to us about what it's like to be in action like that, and then transfer over to when, I suppose, the crowds stop clapping at some level. So if we can show the video maybe first of David Gillick, it will be really, really good. And then we'll go from there.
Final of the 400 meters for men, defending champion, David Gillick. Two laps of the track. Gillick chasing down Svillams, who's performing very strongly in that outside lane. Gillick has got the advantage on Wissmann inside him. Tobin going quite well too on the inside. And this stagger will unwind, and we'll see just who's where. But Gillick is chasing Svillams. Svillams is the lead. Gillick in second, barging Wissmann out of the way. And Gillick is in contention here, chasing down Wissmann. Svillams, Wissmann behind him. Gillick attacking Svillams down that back straight. Svillams for Germany, Gillick for Ireland. A dramatic 400 metres. Wissmann in third place, Tobin in fourth. Question is, can he accelerate off the bend, David Gillick? It's Gillick against Svillams. Svillams holds on. Gillick attacks. The champion attacks. David Gillick is the champion. David Gillick makes history. David Gillick becomes the first Irishman, the first Irish athlete to retain a European indoor championship. That is absolutely magnificent, absolutely sensational. This is a competitor and a half. David Gillick wins gold for Ireland. David Gillick, the champion of Madrid in 2005, is the champion of Europe in Birmingham in 2007. Once upon a time, a Gaelic footballer with Ballyboden and St. John's, Ballantyre St. John's, I should say. Then subsequently an athlete with Dundrum, South Dublin. And now, for the second time, a gold medal around the neck of an Irish hero. And a week after all the feel-good factor of Croke Park, here's the Irish anthem, Aron Levine, in England. champion of Europe, David Gillick.
Fabulous moment, David. Thank you for joining us. I know you're doing good work in a school there today. Yeah, lots of a busy background to where you're sitting today. A little bit of background for you, David. You know, you still hold both the indoor and the outdoor 400 metres. I mean, that's a fabulous moment you're just watching there. Also, after you left the track, I know you went on MasterChef. People recognise you from winning in the kitchen as well. I know you're an author. You work as well in broadcasting, but you're very passionate about, I suppose, promoting health and well-being and mental health, and also about talking around leaving that behind you. But bring us back there for a moment. What's that like, that the flag's going up and you're standing there representing your nation after that super win?
Yeah, look, it's one of the good days. It's hard to believe that was back in 2007, so many, many moons ago. But yeah, like, you know, when it's playing and I'm watching it, you're completely in the zone. It's in that flow state. It's very instinctive. You know, it's very easy to look at that and kind of go, oh, it looks very easy, but an awful lot of work, an awful lot of things would have went on behind the scenes, and obviously in the weeks, months and years leading up to that moment. But it's definitely, you know, one of those kind of videos I look back with great fondness. And, you know, I think the biggest thing was I had friends and family in the crowd. I just located over to the UK, so I'd made some big changes, and for it all to kind of, you know, come out in a performance like that, and obviously retain that title at that time, which, you know, when you go in to one championship and you win, it's very hard to come back again 2 years later and win again. But no, it's brilliant. It's probably one of those things, I'll be honest, I probably should watch more often.
Well, look, it's just what it reminds me of, though. I mean, you can see the mental fitness. We're on about men and mental health here today. And, you know, Mark was talking about the different demographics of men and the different struggles and challenges that we have. And obviously, you know, as an elite athlete, you know, you have that mental fitness that we associate with somebody who can really, you see people getting into the zone and going and doing that. You leave that behind. You're off the track in 2013. Instead, the applause stops. You know, your body is saying no more of that. And you have to move to a different place. And you've spoken very well about this. And that's why we would like to talk to you today about it as well. You know, the transition out of that, Mark, for people looking, say, oh, it's okay for David, he's an elite athlete, he has it. But then you have to step out of there. And what's that like? And what was it like for you particularly in the challenge?
Like, look, I'll be brutally honest. It was the hardest thing I've had to deal with probably in my life. And people will look at sport and the injuries and the setbacks and maybe the defeats. But, you know, I was very good in the sporting environment to deal with my emotions and my anxiety, the nerves. And I worked on that. I had plenty of strategies and plenty of little tools and tricks I would have used coming into a championship. And, you know, if I was to fast forward a couple of years later from what people have just viewed, you know, I ended up retiring at the age of 30 after a couple of injuries. It got to a point where I wasn't making any kind of money from the sport. I'd lost sponsored. I'd lost my funding from Sport Ireland. So I began to kind of hit the age of 30 and think, what am I going to do? You know, how am I going to raise a family? How am I going to, like, get a mortgage, et cetera, et cetera? All these kind of, you know, challenges began to kind of stack up, and I wasn't running. I simply wasn't doing what I loved to do, and that was run. So I retired, and I simply thought, okay, I've had a good career. I can step away. I can move on. But the harsh reality was I woke up one Monday morning and I thought, okay, well, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? And that was kind of issue number one. And then it was like, who am I? You know, who am I? Like, my identity was so much linked to my sport. And not only just that, all my confidence and self-worth and self-belief came from one area of my life, and that was my athletics. And suddenly that was all gone. So the harsh reality was I had no goal. I had no purpose. I didn't know what I was good at. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And coming from sport where everything is mapped out, your weeks, your months, your years, every four-year Olympic cycle is all mapped out and managed. And plus, you have people around you. You have a coach, you have teammates, you have all these people that are on that same kind of journey as you. And then suddenly you wake up and it's all gone. And like, the isolation, I felt very far removed from my sport. I felt removed from my friends that I'd now kind of come home to, because some of them were 10 years in careers and their lives were in going different directions. And it was a very difficult period, because it was uncharted waters, and I wasn't really prepared for that.
And tell me, was there a sliding scale of the feeling and emotion that you've just expressed there? Or was there a moment somewhere in Dublin off Grafton Street or Clondalkin having a coffee, you said, how did I get here? What was there a moment you said, okay, I have to look at this? And what did you do if that did happen? What were the things that turned that boat around for you?
Yeah, well, I'll be honest with you, Lorcan, it didn't happen overnight. It probably took about nearly 3 years. And that's kind of what I learned. I now look after my mental health, and I will be looking after my mental health for the rest of my life. I look after my physical health, running, going to the gym, whatever it might be. And like, mental and physical is very intertwined. That's something that I didn't really address initially. I simply stopped doing what I love to do, run, exercise, eat well. I panicked. I took the first job that came my way because I got very fixated on money. I thought if I have more money, I'll be happy. I'll be content. I'll be fulfilled. And it wasn't until like late 2015, after going through one job to a new job, it was late 2015 on a Sunday, and we were expecting our first child, when I realized I needed help. And that was the catalyst for me to really kind of go, okay, I need professional help in this space, because I was struggling. And that's what it wasn't one moment in a couple of weeks later. And I think that's the important kind of message. It takes, everybody's different. It can take couple of weeks, it could take months, it could take years. And in my situation, it took a number of years until I realized that I needed to make a call. And interestingly enough, I rang someone who I heard speak at a similar event like this. I was in the audience and I heard someone get up and actually talk about their journey. And I remember sitting in the audience going, that's me, that person's talking to me. And it was that person who I actually knew couple of years ahead of me in school, from my area, played sport at a high level. And I rang him and he said, look, come on down for a cup of tea. And that was day one, if I'm honest.
Was it difficult? You know, when you're an elite athlete, again, you're looking at yourself like that. Was it more difficult, do you think, for yourself as a man coming down that sliding scale to be able to ask for that support? Or did it feel like a kind of a sense of, I shouldn't have to do this? You were so used to being able to do stuff for yourself, by yourself.
Yeah, it was. It was very, very difficult, if I'm honest. And I think, again, coming from sports, it's faster, fitter, stronger, show no weakness. I think as well, I had a certain level of success. So I put an awful lot of pressure on me that my next phase of my life had to be, as successful, if not more. I was also doing well kind of in terms of TV and media. You mentioned Celebrity MasterChef. I won that year. And, people were coming up to me going, geez, Gillick, you're going great. It's brilliant. You've really transitioned well. Whereas inside, I was completely and utterly crumbling. So again, I was mirroring what other people were kind of saying to me. You're doing well. Okay, I have to be well. So I put that pressure on me. So it was very, very difficult to, literally put my hand up and say, you know what? I'm struggling. I'm not dealing with this. And that's what I'm kind of saying. It took an awful long time. And you mentioned something, or someone mentioned something earlier on. It was the people close to me that would come to me and say, oh, look, David, go and talk to someone, my wife, my mum. But anytime the people that were emotionally involved with me would come and tell me to do something, I pushed them away. And that was very hard for the people around me. But those were the people that actually saw the true David in those times. And look, it was very easy to hide. I'd get up, I'd put the mask on, I'd leave the house and be the person that people thought I should be. I'd come home, the mask would come off, and the reality of kind of what was really going on would come out. So it was very difficult to actually express myself openly and honestly.
David, believe it or not, we're running on time. We only had you for 10 or 12 minutes today. Yeah. I want to ask you this, though. There's loads of people watching here today, and what would you say for somebody could be watching and they're in that space, they're in that place. What word of advice would you give to them in relation to getting to that space that the need for nurture, self-care and self-love?
I think the first step is just having a conversation with someone that you trust, someone that you can confide in, and don't be afraid to share it all. I think in my experience, it was a conversation that, when I actually just spoke about how I truly felt, it was almost like a bit of a weight was lifted. And subsequently, what I found was that there was other people that were in kind of similar situations. And that actually gave me a bit of confidence, because for so long, I thought I was the only person that was kind of feeling the way I was. And also that nobody would understand. That was my biggest fear, that nobody would understand me. And I think after having a conversation, it was a starting point. And then from there, I got the professional help. And I just want to make this point as well that I started going to counseling in and working with a clinical psychologist in 2016. I went every week and I still go, and it's so many years later, and it's one of the best things that I've ever done. I think my biggest strength wasn't running around 400 meters in those seconds. It was literally showing an element of vulnerability, and that's enabled me to live the life that I want to live.
David, thank you so much for sharing with us and being with us today. You're still doing super work there, school, working with young people. So much appreciate you being here with us. You really are a champion, and thank you, as I say, very, very, very much. So go well.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, David. But a champion, still a champion, and just really fantastic just to talk to him. We could do it so much more time here today, but that's really, really... Look, and I want to stay here with another David. So before we go to our panel, coming out of that, we're going to bring some of David's conversation to our panelists as well. We have some lovely people on our panel. But I want you to watch a video, folks. It's about 6 or 7 minutes. Sit back and have a watch. It's another David, and it's a wonderful story. David Kelly. And it just shows, maybe again, following on from David's story, it shows where one man can make a difference in relation to building back his resilience and making a difference in community. So please watch.
Morning, my name's Keith Kelly. I'm the founder of Jumps for Goalposts. I'm delighted to be able to speak at your event this morning. Jumps for Goalposts is a volunteer-led movement that encourages men of all ages, backgrounds, races, to come together for an old school game of ball using jumpers for goalposts. Jumpers for Goalposts evolved in 2017 after I wrote a poem reflecting on my own childhood. I was sitting in the garden overlooking the field where I used to play as a kid. And it was a summer's day, beautiful out. The kids were off school and yet the field was empty, and it left me with a sort of a heavy heart. So I wrote a poem called No More Jumpers Thrown Down, and it went viral, and I received messages from all over the world, and from professional footballers, elderly people, you know, it seemed to just resonate with people. So I tried a social experiment, should we say, and I put an offer out on Facebook to see if anyone was interested in coming down to the field and having an old school game of ball. And the response I got was massive, and 70 people turned up on a Sunday morning to have a game of ball. The response since then has been massive. We've had games in Galway, we've had games in Wexford, Kildare, and many other places around the country. We've had guys like international footballers like Richard Sadler, Keith Fatty, Paul Howard arriving down into a housing estate to a little patch of grass to join many men having a game of ball. I suppose Jumpers for Goalposts was an experiment for me because I would have suffered hugely with my own mental health for a great number of years. In 2008, I was stabbed numerous times by an intruder in my house, which was near fatal. And over the next 5 or 6 years, my mental health deteriorated to the extent where I tried to take my own life. So after that, I wanted to sort of find out why I was feeling like this and why I was carrying so much shame and why isolation became my friend at the time. So I went on lots of self-development courses. I got involved with this charity called Suicide Survive, who run mental health programs and wellbeing programs around the country. So I trained up as a facilitator. You know, I had no self-confidence. My self-esteem was gone. So, you know, I started to go on all these workshops, and then I actually trained up as a facilitator. I facilitated mental health programs in prisons and communities around the country. I went back to study. I left school at 15. I went back to study. I went to Maynooth University to study counselling skills. But for a long time, isolation was my friend. So I know what it's like to feel lonely, and that sense of happiness just disappeared. And I wanted some sort of thing to bring people together, to reconnect people. And football for me is a great way of reconnecting with people and bringing people together. Well, what happens with a game jumps for goalposts is, you know, you put a post out. As I said, the response is always great. We sort of initially organised games around Men's Health Week to bring men together. And, you know, a game of jumps for goalposts is exactly what it was when we were kids, you know. I think why it works is because there's no pressure, you know. You don't have to train twice a week to turn up for a game on a Sunday. And I know games go on within communities in, say, leisure centres and stuff. But even a fiver a week or £7 a week, whatever it is to go to a leisure centre, can become a huge barrier to people, you know. So Jumpers for Goalposts is free. If we organise a game for 11 o'clock, you can rock up at 11:15, 11:20, and just jump on the side. That's maybe not doing too well at the minute. People leave their ego on the sideline. You get out and just have a laugh. There's no pressure to be a good footballer. It's just all about having a laugh and reconnecting. I've organised games and I've met people who I hadn't seen from 30 years ago from school, just turning up, and you're able to share stories about life and where you are at the minute. And if there is people struggling, you know, we've been able to signpost them to the services they need to go to. I've been able to bring people on the programs that I facilitate so they can get the tools to maybe cope better with what they're struggling with. I think it's popular because, as I say, it's free. You go to a normal game of football and there's that pressure to win, you know. And Jumpers for Goalposts is all about having a laugh. You know, people come along, they watch, you don't have to join in. You can play for 10 minutes and when you start getting tired, you can drop out. There's always somebody else to come in. You know, there's no heavy tackles. It's really all about having a bit of crack. And when you let down the barriers of being the macho man and stuff like that, it opens up the possibility that, you know, you can share your experiences with people. You don't have to expose yourself to the world, you know. But it's like a bit of networking, because I've seen people making connections that, you know, after games when we're having a chat that, okay, listen, I may not have a bit of work. Some guy might be able to say, well, listen, I can give you a day here. Or some guy who's feeling a bit isolated, he's been able to meet up with someone he's reconnected with for a cup of coffee on a Wednesday. So there's just that sort of magic that happens that, you know, there's no drink involved, because I suppose isolation for me still sort of happens. I'm sober 7 years now. And even if you go to a funeral nowadays, as soon as the person goes into the ground, the next thoughts is, right, mom, everyone off to the pub. I know we'd go home. And there is that sense of isolation. So Jumpers for Goalposts, it's about getting people outdoors to enjoy themselves and seeing the value of getting outdoors and reconnecting with people and sharing stories. Because I fully believe if you open up and share your experience, if you're at a place where you can do that, it can help people to open up as well, you know, and reach out for help. I hope today is a real success for you with the events you're putting on, and I hope to see you in the future. Very best of luck with all you do.
Give him a ball and a yard of grass. He'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him a ball and a yard of space.
Jumpers for Goalposts, and apologies there to Keith for calling him David. I know his name as well as my own. So Keith, if you're with us today, watching as well as allowing us to use that video, thank you so very much. Super initiative. And we're going to bring some of that in, you know, bringing people out of isolation and supporting them to find community. Fantastic. Our panel are starting to appear here. We said we're going to have our panel discussion with some really good people that are going to lead on from where we were earlier on. And I'm going to start introducing them there to you now. So stay with us, folks, for the next while as we go into the last part of our webinar. First up, we have Martin Rogan. Martin's there on the right-hand side on my screen anyway. And Martin's 30 years experience, the CEO with Mental Health Ireland. He has a huge amount of experience, a former chair of the International Initiative for Mental Health Leadership. He said he has the privilege of working with many families, communities and initiatives over the years. And he's learned a lot of skills across a wide range of things from mental health, law, service design, program development. Martin, you're very, very welcome. And thank you for being here with us today. We also have, I think, John O'Brien is here. He's the managing National Traveller Mental Health Service at the Exchange House in Ireland. And I only got to know John fairly recently. It's lovely you're here joining us, John. I know you have a huge amount of experience as well, especially working with men and men who perhaps have come from a place of social and economic backgrounds where there's been inequality. You're working now with the traveller community, and for the last number of years, I know you've been very involved as well in promoting positive mental health in the traveller community. So I'm delighted that you're here with us. And then we have Rebecca. Rebecca's here from the IMS, the Irish Men's Sheds Association, and she's the lead in health and wellbeing, and her role involves engaging and supporting men in 450 sheds. Tell us more about that in a moment, Rebecca. You have a huge amount of experience and qualification in other areas. We've gone over time, so I'm not going to go into that now because I want to just start our conversation. So I'm going to bring you in here on the panel so we can have a chat together. And it's really, really good that you're here. Martin, can I start with yourself? Because even this morning when I got up, I have the little booklets here. I use your little booklets there from stress and anxiety and whatever from your service. I find them, they're generic, but they're super, even in relation to any of us men. I find them a really, really good help. In relation to today and just coming on here today, earlier on, Mark talked about the service. He said, like, you know, we've come a long way in relation to services and reaching out and connecting with men, especially in relation to our mental health. What do you think are the key things that we have now that we didn't have before, maybe 10 years ago even?
I think what's really helpful, I suppose, is that we're actually having the conversation, and even an event like today is a really important part of putting men into mental health. Because for a long time, people simply didn't have this conversation. It was taboo, it was discouraged, et cetera. So thankfully, we're a bit more honest and open, and certainly for younger people. I think younger people are showing a great maturity about having a conversation about mental health. It's a more hopeful piece. But it's also, it's one where people are beginning to charge up their own mental health and take responsibility in terms of saying, how do I protect my own mental health? But recognizing it's an active pursuit, but it's not a solo pursuit. So a lot of people watching today might have a concern about a family member, might be their dad, brother, a mate. And it's actually useful tools that people can do. And simple booklets like it's described there are designed to be introductory piece, saying we can understand this, there's a way through, and we can make great progress. So I think things have come on a long, long way. We're not fully there yet. Stigma hasn't been completely extinguished. And particularly for the individual who sometimes might feel that they're unique or alone or some way different. And that can be a feature of sometimes having a mental health need. And you've heard radio ads, you've seen TV, you've seen agencies, you've seen national days. It's really about encouraging people, more people into the conversation, so they can care for themselves and look out for people around them. So I think it's come a really long way in the last number of years, but not quite there yet.
Are there a struggle, or is there a struggle still for, as I say, we were talking about earlier with Mark, for certain demographics of men and trying to reach the services, services like you have, for example, that are very community based and have a really good outreach? Are you still finding that for men to turn up and use your service, the numbers are smaller?
I think sometimes there can be a tendency for men to think that, you know, this will resolve itself, it'll go away. I had a good friend who used to drive an old Renault, and the whole dashboard had a series of little warning lights, little diodes. And every time you turned the ignition, it lit up like a Christmas tree. And I said, you really need to get that looked at. You want to get that service, you want to talk to someone about that. And eventually, one by one, the diodes burnt themselves out. And his view was, I told you there was nothing wrong. I just kept driving. But it wasn't optimal. So sometimes there is a tendency, we get up in the morning and say, it's just today, I'll shake it off, I'll be fine. And in some instances, yeah, these can be self-correcting. But there are times when, and we need to know where are our natural limits. Where's the point where you need to say, actually, I need to chat to a friend, somebody I trust, someone who understands this, reach out to a helpline or chat to your GP. And a lot of people don't necessarily see their GP as a source of support, but we know that about 35% of all GP visits in Ireland relate to a mental health topic. But we also know that people sometimes go up to three or four times with a range of different concerns before they'll actually articulate, saying, I'm feeling down, I'm feeling anxious, I've got no enjoyment, my energy level has dropped out. And it's really important to have a full physical check to see this could be actually associated with, you know, diabetes or another health concern. So let's rule that out and then focus on what is the need, what's the concern, and what you want to do about that. So it's a much more progressive space and much more active space. And I think more and more people begin to understand that and embrace the need to, you know, life's to be enjoyed, not to be endured. So if you're finding, you know, you just don't have the same energy or the same enthusiasm, you're falling away from hobbies, you're not active and social. And we know since COVID, many people's routines got a bit disrupted. It's about rejoining, picking up the threads and getting back involved again.
Okay, thanks very much. John, traveller men's health, young traveller men's health, inequalities. You know, talk to me about your own background in the work. I see the wonderful work you are doing with the traveller men themselves and some of the videos and some of the postings that you've had in relation to reducing that and taking away that stigma that Martin's just mentioned. What are you finding in your own community, in the community where you're working, in relation to raising awareness of supporting traveller men to use services or to make that phone call or talk to a friend?
Thanks, Lorcan. I suppose, look, at the issues for the traveller community are wide. They're very, and I suppose that they're very much interlinked amongst each other. There's no kind of issue that happens in isolation. And I suppose some of the big ones around accommodation, lack of employment opportunities, education. I suppose they're some of the bigger issues. And then, you know, where does mental health fit into all of that? We know the outcomes for the community are pretty stark when it comes to mental health around suicide and suicidal ideation, and the rates that are there don't paint a good picture. So I suppose, where do we start? It's very much trying to get people involved in the solution rather than coming in, I suppose, with the thinking the service kind of has a solution. You have to get the people who are experiencing the inequalities, who are experiencing the deprivation. They're the ones that know best, almost, in terms of the struggle and in terms of the you know, what's affecting them. So by offering them the opportunity to express that has allowed us, I suppose, develop services and develop tools for better engagement, and some of those I was speaking to you about over the last couple of months have been, you know, around using the arts, for example. We did a filmmaking piece and an acting piece with a group of men who made a series of films which, you know, when you talk about trying to reach the hard to reach, these films really went at the heart of it because they were real, they were authentic, they helped, I suppose, traveller men probably more so answer that question: do people like me do things like this? And for a lot of men, when it comes to maybe, you know, going to counselling or looking for support, do you know what, actually I don't do that, you know, I'm not going to a counsellor. That might be a little bit you know, seen as a soft approach or not really, you know, I need to man up or whatever it might be, you know. So
What have you found, John, just to stay with you for a moment, that's normalizing the conversation for the traveller men in relation to their health and mental health? You know, how do you normalize that?
Well, I think, I suppose what Martin kind of said there, yes, it's becoming that bit easier. There's much more talk in mainstream media and social media and on TV around mental health. There's much more advertising, you know, there definitely is, you know, even in schools with young people, there's just more... you know, there's more language and more terminology and more phrases being used, and that definitely helps. But I suppose being upfront with people as to, you know, what the service actually is, you know, it's a mental health service. You know, we're here to try and prevent suicide. And when you can, you know, I suppose, particularly around suicide, people are often afraid of even mentioning the word, because if you mention the word, it might plant a seed. When we know, you know, from our training and from what we do, when we actually, it's more of a preventative, you know, when we start talking about. So yeah, I suppose it comes back to language. It comes back to giving people the skills from the community itself. I'm not a traveller myself, and that presents its own challenges. So it really is about upskilling and empowering community members to kind of get involved.
Okay, thank you, John. Rebecca, you've vast experience and you have so many sheds across Ireland. I know they're starting to come back and consolidate again post-COVID, and they're an older group of men in many cases, not in all cases. Mm. But you have sheds for life. You know, we often hear men work shoulder to shoulder, but indeed, you know, it's proving the point that the normalization I'm talking to John about is happening very much in sheds where men and older men are talking about all kinds of things they mightn't have imagined about. What's that experience been like for you to be part of progressing?
Yeah, I mean, it's, excuse me, it's really an extraordinary, I mean, I think congratulations today for a start, because I think you're modeling a great approach here today. We're having a conversation. We live in perhaps, you know, the most connected society we've ever lived in. And yet on many levels, we can be very disconnected. And I think there's a lot of older people who can feel, particularly coming out of the last 2 years, and we would come across it, there's still a lot of disconnection and social anxiety, and that would be our experience. So for me, what we see in sheds, what works for sheds, the power of sheds, and as you said, there are 450 plus of them with a waiting list of groups of men waiting to become sheds of 30 to 40. It's connection. If you were to put your finger on it, it is connection. And there's two aspects, I think, to it. Bearing in mind that, each shed is as individual as the men who come into it, and each individual man is on his own mental health or well-being journey. As David said earlier, it's hard to extricate mental health and physical health. We take it as a whole. Our approach is the holistic piece. Men are able to come into a shed and be themselves. They will get whatever they need out of the shed. And again, it's interesting. Somebody said earlier, I think Mark said it, it offers a place to download. It's a place you can go for support. It's a place you can go and have a chat. It's also the shed environment, by its very nature, is kind of unique. They're everywhere, but they're in communities, but they're kind of set apart from communities in that it is a health promoting environment. You can go in and you can chat and you can learn together and you can do stuff together, shoulder to shoulder. You said it there earlier. And that's kind of quite different. That's a different experience. Women tend to be, it's easier for women to go out and do the social thing face to face. Men in sheds will talk while they are doing other stuff. And that's our experience. And the other piece, somebody spoke about it earlier, and there's a lovely parallel with what David said earlier, in terms of transitioning different periods of your life. Predominantly, we work with men in their 60s and 70s. Having said that, you know, the demographic can run from 20 to 90, but we would see a lot of men going through change. And change obviously can bring a lot of stress or anxiety. So we would have retirement, or we could have illness or loss or whatever it is. And a shed can be a source of stability and support for people who are going through change. And that's something that men can find a lot within sheds, within their communities.
Okay. There's a question, Rebecca, that's come in, and it's kind of linked, because I know with Sheds for Life, you partner a lot, and the partners are very important. We're your partners here today, talking on the screen together. And there's a question in relation to that there about community. How in community can we respond? And just from our experience, even yourself, maybe Martin, just how important is that, you know, the shared experience for all of us to be working much more closely together in our response to normalize our conversations for men in relation to mental health and well-being?
Yeah, I think it's really, really important. I suppose we're pack animals, you know, so, you know, we need other people. We need affirmation. We need to, you know, have our own ideas, have our own identity, but we also need to, you know, interact with people. And, you know, even some of the advice we used to give to people in COVID during the times of lockdown was just go outdoors, be seen and see other people, because it has a regularizing effect. But there's no doubt if you hit a bump in the road, you'll do your best to mobilize your own resource around that. But even just to explain it to somebody else as best you can, and you may not feel you're getting perfectly at what you want to say, but you can actually see a route through it, you can see a pathway through it. And I think it's really important, particularly in our community today. And as Rebecca said, sometimes they tend to have an older demographic, men using the men's sheds. But I suppose what's really important in a natural community, you have all the strata. So you've got the elders of a community, wise people, and they're not going to rush in with a solution or an answer or say, try this, it worked for me. But you're going to be able to say, yeah, that is difficult, but actually you'll come through this. And maybe in 2 weeks' time, we'll even look back and think, this is hilarious. But today we recognize this is difficult for you. Just to have that support. One of the programs we run, for example, is a simple one called Hello, How Are You? With over 300 events across the country at the end of March. And it was simply just to encourage people to say, how's it going? And we've extracted it from a program that's done, started in Philadelphia, then New York, then London, called Thrive. One of the very simple things they did in London, they got two deck chairs, they got a pizza box, tore the lid off the pizza box, and wrote the word helper on one piece and helped on the other. Left them on the two deck chairs and stood back to see what would happen. And after about 20 minutes, two men came along and sat down in the chairs. One was a cop and the other was a homeless guy. And they were having a conversation. What was interesting is that the cop sat in the chair saying, helped, and the homeless guy was the helper. So basically, the cop had had a falling out with a buddy. He missed him. They used to go and play sports together and whatever, and now they weren't talking. And the homeless guy said, well, I've actually a lot of time on my hands and a lot of life experience. But so they stepped out of their usual roles and were just two humans saying, how's it going for you? That is such a powerful thing. That we all absolutely need. And we have to kind of look back over the last 24 hours, last week or so, and say, how many times have you actually had a genuine conversation with someone? Not just a, how's it going, how's the weather, or whatever, but in terms of just checking in with someone. And we know that if you ask someone, how are you doing? They'll probably say, I'm fine. If you ask a second time, if you're a little bit concerned about them, they're much more likely to say, I'm glad you asked. And we're not asking people to spill their guts or have a big psychotherapy session on the footpath.
Yeah, yeah.
Just to check in. Really, really important.
John, would you agree with that? Championing, going back to your videos and your social media, I see you have some really wonderful men who are championing what Martin is talking about, the normalization and conversation of, where it's really at for them. That's important, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And the use of role models and not just kind of the celebrity role model, that the person in everyday life, the young guy who's come from a background where education hasn't been high on the agenda, but he's now suddenly attending school, for other peers to see him, with his bag on his back going in the front door of a college, or a young guy, going into an apprenticeship where there's been a history of high unemployment. I mean, it just can't be underestimated because, I think it was Davis might have mentioned, the need for purpose in the life. You have to have that purpose, but you also have to be able to see that purpose. And again, I mentioned a little bit earlier, that question that we all ask ourselves, do people like me do things like this? And you need those role models, and not just the celebrity role models. It has to be, people who you know and who you can follow and who you, that are not up on a pedestal way up the line, they've given you something achievable. So yeah, it can't be underestimated, the power of having, role models there or for want of a better maybe term for it. Yeah.
I'm just conscious as well, coming back to Rebecca, we're running on time, but I want to just do a final round with us as well. Capacity building, there's a lot of people watching today, maybe who are part of services, and we have the Engaged National Mental Health Training Program, which is evidence-based, and it's a relational approach to, I suppose, really engaging training day that's out there. Keep an eye out for it, folks, and do sign up for it if you haven't been on it. That's more generic in relation to engaging with men. Rebecca, and as partners, we work together and we've done quite a bit of work together. How important is that to build capacity as partners together and to, share our stories, strengthen our skills base so that we are going back to what Mark said at the beginning, we're learning as we go and we're moving things along. That's important.
Absolutely. And I mean, somebody said it earlier, it all, you know, collaboration is at the heart of everything we do, but it's collaboration with the men we go with. We're built around, we're led by men for men, and our approach is collaborative. You know, we go from what the men need and we build all our partnerships around that. But we work very, very hard at building collaborations and partnerships that are very creative. And we bring people to the shed, and that's an integral part as well of what we do. And we make sure that we do engage training. We invite our facilitators, everybody we work with, we do gender-specific training with them. We do shed-specific training with them. We bring people into sheds. So there's a lot of kind of education about sheds and the environment of sheds and working with men. We put a lot of effort into that. 10,000 men a week were going in and out of sheds pre-COVID, which is a huge volume of people. And there's huge learning in that for everybody we work with. And we work with everybody from the Irish Heart Foundation to the Alzheimer's Society of Ireland. And there's huge learning. We're going to have this massive demographic change over the coming years. So we need to have things in place. Sheds are not kind of one thing as a standalone, but they are certainly part of the jigsaw in how we can kind of explore a way for older men to embrace positive aging and encourage positive mental health as part of that package, if you like. They're part of the jigsaw. So it makes sense to have partnerships and everybody working together and conversations, you know. So stuff like this is brilliant, where we can get together and share and learn from each other, you know.
Well, hopefully it is brilliant, and hopefully it's adding to a kind of a momentum that's out there. Very, very briefly, and very briefly, I mean, just a word, there's people who maybe have used your services, folks, and are part of your services. A quick word to anybody who's looking in again today, just from yourselves, the individuals, the word of, you know, they maybe need to get somewhere, they need to make a phone call. What would you say, Martin, very, very briefly?
I'd say I'd probably take Nike's advice. Just do it. Take that step. Don't overthink it. Don't think of all the things that might go wrong for you. Visualize it going well and take that step. Reach out. And there's lots of support, and people are really generous with their skills and are very happy to help.
Thanks very much, Martin. Rebecca, for your own demographic of men, the lovely group of men that you work with across the country.
Not everybody is online. Yeah. Not everybody. Don't presume, particularly with our audience, that people are online or have access to websites or anything. So always we would provide phone numbers and support that way. As many different possibilities for people to access support is really important, particularly for our audience.
Okay, very good. And it just reminds me of the video we just watched before we came into this space, where something can happen in community. So simple, jumpers for goalposts with Keith Kelly. It's really remarkable. So not everybody is online, and some of the really good work is done, like you're doing as well, John, outside with men in circles and men in groups. John, a word yourself just to us.
I suppose that would be my line of advice was while it's fantastic, there are so many services and professionals out there to support your mental health nowadays. Often the strongest support you'll have is in your own kind of peer network, family, friends, and don't be afraid to reach out to them, because, you know, they're often the ones we're hiding, you know, our issues from, because we don't want to impact them, but they're probably the greatest support that we have.
Look at folks, thank you so much for sharing with us today and giving your time here. We've ran a little bit over time, so we've smaller time for Fergal, who's going to come on here in a moment. I said at the beginning we were hoping to have a sacred conversation. I think it has been, and thank you for bringing your experience and sharing it with us today. Folks, I'm going to leave you over to Fergal. Thank you very, very much for staying with us, and until we meet again, please do go well, mind yourself, and do ask for that support and get it if you need it. Thanks, Fergal.
Thank you, Lorcan. Thank you very much. So just in terms of the closing remarks here, a few things I want to mention there. So in case anybody doesn't know me, I'm Fergal Fox. I work in HSE Health and Wellbeing. I cover stakeholder engagement and communications. and I also lead on the Healthy Ireland Men Plan. And I'm really delighted to see how today's webinar has gone. We started doing these webinars, I think this is our 10th men's health webinar. We started doing them in 2020. And we have some of those recorded podcasts. So the message today is really has been trying to support people to engage with men. And this year we're trying to develop more messages for men themselves, for the public. And today is was the first of 2023. And as Lorcan said, we hope you can stay with us during the year. We'll be planning another one for Men's Health Week. And Men's Health Week is one of the things I just want to really highlight today as something that everybody, whether you're working on your own or in a group, that people can engage with through MHFI.org. Men's Health Week is an annual event. This year it starts on the 12th of June. It just gives you an opportunity to do something practical in your community, with your group, or just for yourself in the area of men's health. So I really, really encourage you to do something during Men's Health Week. And if you want to tell us about it, we'll be reaching out to everybody that's registered for this webinar through a follow-up email, and we'll give you some of those signposts. One of the other things that projects that we're doing in health and wellbeing at the moment is we're trying to improve the way that our services help people around physical activity. And we're looking for men to engage in a survey around physical activity services. So we'll give the link to that survey in the follow-up email, but we'd really appreciate some men to feedback to us. We're looking for men between the ages of 35 and 60 who are less physically active than they'd like to be, and they'd help us. So this survey has been done by the Southeast Technological University in Ireland. They're a partner with us on this project. So other things that we're kind of doing that we'd kind of like to highlight for you at the moment is our podcast series. We launched a new HSE Health and Wellbeing podcast series at the start of March. It's called HSE Talking Health and Wellbeing. It's available wherever you get your podcasts and on our HSE Health and Wellbeing YouTube channel. And in the context of men's health, we've already launched a podcast episode on men's health with Dr. Noel Richardson, which Lorcan referenced earlier on. So just to, I suppose, sum up today, one of the kind of big two themes that I heard today was that kind of challenge around transition and the challenge around connection and the call out for people to be connected with men for men's health. So I just like to really express my appreciation to all the speakers and the planners behind the scenes that helped pull the webinar's content today, particularly Keith Kelly, David Gillick, John O'Brien, Martin Rogan, and Rebecca McLaughlin, all really, really chaired excellently by Lorcan, who's bringing us through this, as Rebecca said, in the exact way that we want. You know, we're working through the model that we're encouraging others to work through in a very supportive, caring way. So that's it from us. I really appreciate you joining us today, and I hope you can join us in the future. Thank you very much.